The Village of Lisle Planning and Zoning Commission for June 9th, 2021. Tonight's meeting is a hybrid public and virtual meeting. The public may participate either by attending Village Hall. Village Hall is open, and all interested parties can participate virtually by joining the video conference with the link that's available on the agenda for tonight's meeting. I'll call the meeting to order. If Director Smetana, if you could take the roll.
Commissioner Biederstadt?
Here.
Commissioner Biederstadt?
Here.
Commissioner Trussell?
Here.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Here.
Commissioner Bauer?
Here remotely.
Chairman Zidell?
Here. At this time, we'll have public comment, but this portion of the public comment is with respect to general public comment that is not regarding items that are on tonight's agenda. Public comment is limited to 5 minutes. And if possible, one spokesperson per group. Does anyone have any public comment for items that are not on tonight's agenda? And Director Smetana, is there anybody online for general public comment?
No, there's not, Chairman.
Okay. Moving on, we will consider approval of the meeting minutes of the May 19th, 2021 Planning and Zoning Commission. Everyone should have gotten a copy of revised meeting minutes this afternoon. Can I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Second.
And Director Smetana, if you could take the roll.
Commissioner Biederstadt?
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell?
Aye.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Aye.
Commissioner Bauer?
Aye.
Chairman Zidell?
Aye. And the motion passes and the minutes are approved. At this time, we're going to reopen the continued public hearings regarding the zoning code rewrite. This is PZC 2020-12, PZC 2020-13, and PZC 2020-14. Can I have a motion to reopen the continued public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Director Smetana, please take roll. Did I lose Director Smetana? Yes, we did.
Chairman Zidell?
Yes.
Before we proceed, I just want to ask, from a technological perspective, is it possible that there's something wrong with the audio? I have my computer volume turned all the way up and it's barely audible.
Okay, how about if I talk louder? Would that be better? How's that?
It's really not different, but thank you.
Well, I'm getting nods in the room, so something's a little better. Okay, I'll try and talk louder if that helps. We're at roll call for reopening the continued public hearings.
Commissioner Biederstadt?
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell?
Aye.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Aye.
Commissioner Bauer?
Aye.
Chairman Zidell?
Aye. This is a continuation of a long process of the zoning code rewrite. And for those who are unaware, the last time we had a meeting was a couple of months ago. This has sort of been an iterative process where there's ongoing public comment and general review by the commission on a chapter-by-chapter basis. We are looking tonight at the edition called edition number 7. We'll give you an idea how many revisions of this we've been through. I'd like to start with anybody who's come here tonight. Regardless of what chapter or what portion you'd like to comment on, but general public comment regarding the zoning code, any portion of it that you'd like to comment on, just come to the podium, please.
Good evening.
Do you state your name?
I will. My name is Michael Roth, spelled R-O-T-H, and I'm an attorney representing...
Gave testimony before or no?
Negative.
Okay, I need to swear you in then.
Okay.
Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay, thank you. You can proceed.
So I represent Pritchett Realty and the Lisle Business Center, which I think you're all familiar with on the north side of Ogden Avenue at Western Court. And our area of interest tonight is with regards to the zoning of those kinds of uses in the under consideration for amendment, particularly the proposed language with regards to warehousing and similar types of uses. I hope you received my letter. Mm-hmm. And if you did, that will certainly abbreviate everything for me. And I sent it over to Mike Smentana as well. There can be no doubt but that that land use regulation and zoning has evolved significantly over the last 10 years, particularly in regards to these kinds of uses, these related uses, warehouses, distribution centers, logistics facilities, freight terminals, that really there's a new link in the chain, if you will, of the distribution of goods, and that is that there's a new level of much more direct from warehousing to end user than there ever was before, and certainly much more so than ever existed at the time the Village of Lisle adopted its ordinances, and all the other communities, I think, adopted their ordinances as well. And there are important distinctions. They may be subtle, but there are important distinctions between the types of uses that are allowed as warehousing versus distribution versus logistics, et cetera. And I think it's important, and I applaud you for taking on the issue, because I think it's a very important issue. Many, many municipalities have not yet acted on this. And what is the best way to deal with it? Because the reality of these uses doesn't really match what the zoning codes necessarily say. And I think the most important aspect of this is that the subtleties in the different types of what one would call warehousing or other kinds of uses don't appear in the definitions in your codes. It's a definitional issue, I think, more so than anything else. In my letter, we've said we recommend to you that that you require that warehouses be special uses. And I know that there's been significant pushback on that concept. But like so many other areas of zoning law over the last many years, it is important that the zoning be precise. And I would submit that it's extremely difficult to, in a regulatory way, wrap your arms around this area of land use. How do you distinguish between these different kinds of uses when they're very similar to one another, but the distinctions between them are pretty darn critical. And the reason that they're critical is because they affect the adjacent or surrounding properties, but also more so than probably anything, traffic. Traffic is the big issue. I think it's been pointed out there are so many municipalities that have not caused warehouses to be special uses, and that may be true either because they haven't gotten around to it, or because their definitions distinguish between these different uses adequately. Well, Lisle's doesn't. Lisle has the freight terminal concept. Lisle has the warehouse concept. Lisle has different kinds of distribution concepts that aren't adequately distinguished in the zoning code, and I think they. And I think while it may be a laudable effort to do so in the language that's proposed to you, it really doesn't, it doesn't make a meaningful distinction that is going to solve the kinds of problems that my client has suffered and the village has suffered, I think, over many years. I mean, this has been certainly the Ogden Industrial Park has been a thorn in the side. It's been a headache for not just the residents in the area and the businessmen in the area, but for the village of Lisle as well. I mean, there's been, we know the history of it, cut through traffic and all the problems that come with it and have come with it. And, you know, and I think if we were to, you know, if we had had a crystal ball and could go back to the time that this area was zoned, you probably wouldn't have zoned it industrial, you know? You probably would have zoned it something else. But we are where we are, and so now what do you do about it? Do you take a Band-Aid approach? I don't think so. You know, the village of Lisle, like every other community and its zoning ordinances, has many, many, many special use categories. The fact that something is categorized as a special use doesn't make that property unmarketable. It's still marketable. It's just that the village can use its good judgment with regards to conditions that are or are not, that are important to that particular piece of property. That's the nature of special uses. And whether you call it special uses, conditional uses, special permits, what have you, the village should be allowed the opportunity to evaluate these uses, including warehouses, because of the definitions that you have that don't adequately distinguish between warehouses and logistics facilities, or fulfillment centers, if you will. That's what you have. And even under the language that is being proposed, there are not sufficient distinctions to allow the village to deal with traffic planning, for example, or the particular area that's surrounding this industrially zoned property. We have a unique situation in the industrial park here, the Ogden Industrial Park. It is a unique situation. But you're not killing a fly with a sledgehammer by saying a special use permit is something that's appropriate, unless you are very precise in your distinctions and there's no overlap in your zoning code regulations. I think that the village of Lisle can and should adequately deal with this situation. But the subtleties between how long goods are stored at a particular warehouse, what type of vehicles are going to be moving those products around, what the volume of traffic is going to be for a particular warehouse, if you will, or distribution center, or perhaps there's overlap. You know, some of the communities, I think, that have been cited by the pension fund for the 4,500 property, some of these communities have definitions where the fulfillment centers, the logistics facilities, are in fact expressly deemed to be freight terminal facilities. The DuPage County has now created a new zoning classification for fulfillment centers, logistics facilities that's not even industrial. Some of the communities that have been cited to you don't even have industrial zoning, and many of them, while they might not require a special use permit, they do require site plan approval. And as a condition of site plan approval, you got to have a traffic plan. And it only makes sense. And you know, if it's out in an established industrial park, then maybe there won't be any special conditions for that particular warehouse or distribution facility. But when you have other properties that are, and maybe have been historically designated as industrial zoning for warehouses, but it really doesn't fit, or it doesn't fit anymore, then really you should have that power. You should have the ability to evaluate these cases, use your good judgment, and protect the residents in the area, the businesses that are already operating there, and take into consideration the types, for example, of truck traffic. You know, are they going to be semis, or is it going to be 150 Amazon, you know, vans going in and out every day? You should have the ability to evaluate those things. So that's our position. I would suggest to you that a special use permit or classification is the right way to deal with it. Like, give yourself the authority and the power to deal with these things in your good judgment. And I think the whole community would be much better off if you did. So,
yeah. Mind if I ask
right.
you
Thank
question.
You very much.
Can I ask you one quick question?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Sure. Your client's property is, and from my perspective, a flex property, right? Like flex office industrial, is that what you would consider
it's service and offices. It's offices and services. But I think flex is probably a fair
like manufacturing capability?
Not manufacturing. Mike Pritchett is here, and he can tell you more precisely what they're doing inside the building.
Sure. I was just wondering if there was an industrial component to it.
Well, it's service. So it's services going on. And they're, Mike, you want to?
Well, I would
Well, all right. Well,
please, come on up.
Maybe he'd be better off than me to give the specifics.
I just want to understand the nature of your client's properties within the industrial district, if they would be considered a manufacturing, a warehouse, or if it's just office located within an industrial park.
It's more than just office.
That's what I thought.
But that's what it is primarily.
Right.
That's what it is primarily, and I think that's the character of this particular area. But that's a big distinction between that kind of use and the Amazon or the DHL.
Sure,
that
had been a flex there. Space.
And if you just load them all in under one warehouse category or industrial category, then...
Well, it makes the compatibility an issue.
It really does.
I think that's it.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. And you've been sworn in before, correct?
I should be sworn in.
Okay. Just state your name, and do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Mike Pritchett, I do.
Okay, thank you. Proceed.
Okay. Well, Mike gave a very good description of what our properties do. About 158,000 square feet of one-story office building with truck docks and loading and air-conditioned service space. The space is probably built out, in roughest terms, about overall, if you average it, about 80% office, I would say. But there is some light assembly, there's repair, there's some warehousing. It just depends upon the tenant. And the fact that we have the truck docks is an important feature of what we do that distinguishes us from other office buildings. So Lisle Business Center is three one-story office buildings on the north side of Western Avenue, literally right next to 4500, did I say Western Avenue? They're on Western Court, right next to 4500 Western Avenue, which I'm going to mention here a couple of times. We started this development in 1984, 37 years ago. So I'm going to talk about some of my personal experience at this location, and I hope it will be useful. But specifically, we're going to recommend and ask that, one, the freight terminal facility should continue to be a special use. And of course, that's the intention of the Plan Commission. But secondly, we want to follow the staff's original recommendation to deal with the types of use and definitional issues that Mike Roth raised. We think that a special use permit should be required for a warehouse use, because it's so hard to define really what's going to be going on in the space, and it could start out as one thing and then turn into another. We want to avoid the Amazon type facility, which we'll talk about. And then thirdly, we think that any proposed warehouse use in excess of 25,000 square feet and any freight terminal facility should be required to provide a professional traffic study, because that's what we're really talking about here for the most part, is how much traffic and what's the nature of the traffic. So freight terminal facility, previous problems in this business park. In July of 2005, there were so many problems caused by the DHL building at 4500 Western Avenue that the village passed a text amendment to the zoning ordinance that made a freight terminal facility a special use. And everybody knew at the time that it didn't apply to DHL because they were grandfathered. They were already in place. But we also knew that it would apply to any future freight terminal facility in the park or at that location, 4500 Western Avenue. But what happened 10 years later, Amazon leased 4500 Western Avenue for a logistics freight terminal operation. But Amazon did not apply for a special use permit. They applied for and received a certificate of occupancy for a warehouse. And as you know, this caused tremendous problems in the village. It was a problem for the adjoining properties. It was a problem for the residents, particularly on Middleton and Yinder. It was a problem for the village staff and the Lisle Police Department. And this problem went on from 2015 through 2020 until Amazon left and moved over to an arterial road on Finley Road in Downers Grove. And the problem did not end until Amazon left. And in fact, there were continuing problems of negotiations and discussions within the village after that. But at least the traffic dropped off when Amazon left. When it became apparent that Amazon was conducting a freight terminal logistics building at this facility, the village staff asked Amazon to apply for a special use permit. Amazon, of course, was already in business at that time. Amazon basically said, no, we're not going to do that. They have refused to apply for the special use permit. This left the village and the adjoining property owners only the right to sue, to try to enforce the village's code. Not really the job of the adjoining property owners to have to enforce the village's code. No lawsuit was filed, as far as we know, and the problems continued, as I said, unabated until Amazon left in 2020. This problem was really costly to the village. Not only the annoyance to the businesses and to, the residences, the staff time, the elected officials' time, but the village hired Civil Tech Engineering to do a traffic study of the northwest quadrant of Ogden and Yackley. This study took place, an expensive study, as a result of Amazon being at 4500 Western Avenue. And one of the points of information gathered by this study was, and this was done in October of 2019, this was before Amazon left. You can picture where Middleton Avenue is, going out from the business park out to Yackley. There were 1,900 vehicles per day using Middleton Avenue. And this, far and away, most of it came from Amazon. And this was an example of the kind of problem that was caused by a freight terminal facility in that business park. If Amazon had been required to apply for a special use permit in 2015, if there was some question or controversy about what they really were going to do there, well, at the very least, you know, it had to be recognized that, you know, if you read the newspaper in those days, you knew what Amazon was getting ready to do. They were getting ready to do the last mile business, and that's the freight terminal facility. In any event, if they had been required to apply for the special use permit, the application and review process would have resulted in an evaluation of the precise nature of what they were going to do, and it would have been an appropriate way to determine whether it was a traditional warehouse or a freight terminal facility or some kind of combination of the two, which needed to be dealt with in a regulatory way. So that is this history with Amazon. Well, DHL and Amazon is a very good example of why a special use permit should be required for a warehouse or freight terminal facility in these circumstances. A couple of other points. The characteristic of the 4500 Western Court Avenue are also another particularly good example of why a special use permit should be required. When 4500 Western Avenue was built in 1979 and 80, it was developed for use by unit trucks. We're talking about, well, the opposite of a tractor trailer, a unit truck. They're not really very long, and they could function okay with a building that was located 26 feet from the public right-of-way. Public right-of-way, 26 feet, and the trucks, unit trucks, could back in and out of there okay. Of course, trucks have gotten only longer since then, and the what I just described, a building 26 feet from the public right-of-way, doesn't accommodate the 53-foot long trailers plus tractors, which are most common today. So what we end up with is a conflict between the traffic on Western Avenue and the trucks, tractor-trailer trucks, using Western Avenue public right-of-way for truck staging and maneuvering. Now, with respect to 4500 Western Avenue, the two most recent uses of this building were, as we talked about, DHL from 2003 to 2008 and Amazon from 2015 to 2020. Neither of these uses were warehouse uses, even though Amazon, and now the owner of that building, TIAA, claim and otherwise, TIAA in their February 16th, 2021 letter said that the building has been operated as a warehouse in its time of operation. That's just not accurate. It's been a freight terminal facility all of that time. And in fact, it's unlikely that this building was ever used for a warehouse. Before DHL, I believe it was used for light manufacturing and assembly. So These are our observations and questions, and I'd be happy to answer any questions now or to talk to the staff or whatever.
Do any of the commissioners have any questions for Mr. Pritchett? Nobody? Okay.
Thank you.
And would anybody else like to give public comment? And have you been sworn in previously?
I have not been.
Okay, if you could state your name and...
My name is Scott Day, D-A-Y. I'm with the firm of Day and Robert. We are at 300 East 5th Avenue, Suite 365 in Naperville, Illinois, and I represent TIAA, the owner of the 4500 property.
Okay, and I will swear you in, and do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Okay, please proceed.
Thank you. I submitted a letter earlier this week in opposition to the position that is being advocated by Mr. Pritchett. And let me start by saying the area where we agree. The definition of a freight terminal, I've discussed it with your staff, and I know that you are focused on trying to make sure that the operator and tenants that utilize our client's property are not freight terminals. You want to make sure that you don't have a DHL. You want to make sure that you don't have an Amazon. We know that those particular uses have evolved with the explosive growth of internet shopping and internet service delivery, and they have indeed changed. We know that. We have no opposition to the request or the suggestion that a freight terminal operator should receive a conditional use permit and should apply for one. We understand that. There's no disagreement there. Where we disagree is we disagree with the assertion that somehow that warehousing has become a non-benign land use. There was a suggestion by Mr. Pritchett in his advocacy that there is a marked trend with respect to warehousing as defining it as some sort of an adverse land use that requires microscopic inspection by the municipality. Now, we've provided you with the surrounding communities in their industrial zoning classification, and that is simply not the case. And those are the communities where our clientele and the users of our property are competing for space. Now, I can tell you that I'm not inexpensive, nor is Mr. Roth. I've known Mr. Roth a long time. He works with a very large firm. It's expensive to go through the process for conditional use, and it's time-consuming. And when somebody is relocating and trying to set up business at a new location, the process of going through a special use can make the difference between leasing the property and not leasing the property. And in our earlier correspondence to this village, we have given you the information from our brokers that have been trying to market this property while the village has been going through this comprehensive rezoning for the entire community, and it is indeed a problem. With respect to traffic, I know that you have had traffic on some of the ingress-egress routes to this particular location. Our facility is a 69,000 square foot warehouse facility, and certainly in previous uses, it has contributed to the traffic problem. Mr. Pritchett's property is a multi-tenant facility with nearly 160,000 square feet, so more than twice the size of our facility. Those cars are ingressing and egressing at different times and for different uses. Some of them are office uses, some of them are service uses. Also, somewhat loosely defined land uses in this particular location. If the traffic use at this particular location is driving the concerns, then perhaps we need greater or tighter definitions with respect to office and service uses to make sure that you don't have a call center that's going into a facility like that that typically requires 10 parking spaces per 1,000 square feet. You're dealing with different uses in different areas, and as they transform, you can see that certain uses do require amendments to the zoning. We're in wholehearted agreement with respect to the freight terminals. What we don't want to have is a building that was designed in the 1970s and early 80s to be a warehouse and be left in a situation where the village, through its zoning authority, has denied us any and all permitted use of right. That's the position that we don't want to be in. We're asking that you leave us with a permitted use that is suitable for the building. We think warehousing is that permitted use, and all the rest of the communities have found it adequate to define warehousing as warehousing and recognized it as a benign use. I'll answer any questions you may have at this time.
Do any of the commissioners have any questions?
Council, can you speak to the assertion that a former tenant had used this as a freight terminal but classified as a warehouse?
I can't speak to that. I know from dealing with Mr. Smetana that he asserted that previous administration at the village recognized the Amazon use as not requiring a special use permit. And I know that as your director, he disagrees with that particular assessment. Beyond that, I don't know the administrative machinations that were involved when Amazon was here. I know Amazon is gone. I know that the village has made it very clear that they don't want Amazon. And I know that since I've been representing TIAA, they have given me authority to assert wholeheartedly they don't want Amazon. They don't want Amazon in this building. They don't want a freight terminal in this building. It's too big of a nightmare.
Thank you, Mr. Knight. Mr. Roth, I didn't know if you guys wanted to make a comment behind this, or if you guys are comfortable and we can move forward.
I have one thing to say.
And then Mr. Day, you can certainly, if you want, and then we can kind of move
Thank you, Chairman.
I don't want to be misunderstood as overstating what it is that we're asking for. We have been speaking in terms of special use permits. And as I said, whether it's a special use, conditional use, what have you. What we want is to have the village have the authority to protect the area as need be in each case. So, for example, in the case of a warehouse, as has been described by Mr. Day, it's not going to be a distribution facility. Well, really, I think to Mike Pritchett's points, what's the size of the vehicles that are going to be going in and out of that warehouse? Does it fit the Ogden Industrial Park? What's the size and what's the volume of those vehicles? What's the capacity of the street? Western Avenue, for example, what's the capacity of that street? Does the intersection at Ogden and Western Avenue really fit the bill for semis, which is what I think Mr. Day is saying would be the type of vehicle that would be going to the 4500 Western Avenue property? Is that really what fits here? And I think the answer is no, it doesn't. Those kinds of uses, at least in regards to traffic. And you know, you also have issues where, what is the adjacent property? You know, what's gonna be the noise of these semis? You know, is there noise? Is there fumes? Is there all hours going on? All of these things that it is only fair for the village, the Planning and Zoning Commission, and the Village Board to be able to address as need be. That's what we're asking for. And again, you know, there are lots and lots of special uses categorized in the Village of Lisle's zoning code. And that hasn't hurt the marketability of these properties, and it shouldn't. It shouldn't. Special uses are part of zoning law. Everybody knows it. They come in, they do their due diligence, and generally speaking, the municipalities treat everybody very fairly and appropriately based upon the particulars of the case. So that's it.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Does anyone else have any questions for the two public comments so far?
I mean, I guess, Mr. Roth, I don't mean to call you back down, but I have noticed in the several revisions that we've had that there are amendments that have been made to each of these sections. I'm assuming at your request based upon the change summary that I've received. So what further changes specifically for the public's benefit are you seeking over and above what's already been made?
Well, I would like to see, for example, as many of the municipalities that were cited by Mr. Day in his letter, I'd like to see a site plan requirement. I'd like to see a traffic study be required. And you know, many times what municipalities do is they don't categorize something as a special use, but there are performance standards for different uses. And those performance standards are going to have things like can't make too much noise. It's gotta be suitable for the traffic system that's in place. You know, Paul Haas, who's the zoning director for DuPage County, and he's probably one of the most expertise, land planners that I've had the pleasure of dealing with, I talked to him about it, and he told me about what DuPage County does. And the real critical issue is your warehouse, is your distribution facility, are they on collector streets? Are they on private drives? Are they on arterials in DuPage County? They all have to be on arterial streets. It's the roadway network that's in place that you would be allowed to evaluate on a case-by-case basis. And I just don't think it would necessarily, it doesn't necessarily affect the marketability of the property.
Anybody else?
I hope that answered your question. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is there any other public comment? Come on down.
We have several attendees. Chairman, I will give them an opportunity to speak.
I have someone in the room who's coming down the stairs.
Okay.
Okay. Come on down.
Do you want to take the other ones first?
Nope. Come on.
Good evening, everyone. Madam Chairman, good evening as well. First of all, perhaps a non-agenda item, I'd like to thank former Commissioner Rogers for the time he spent on the commission. And as you know, there's a lot of time. Your job looks easy when we're sitting at home. You don't realize the time that it takes to come to the commission hearings and that and be up to date with respect to what goes on. So I'd like to compliment and thank him for the service that he did provide the village. I think second thing is,
I'm going to interrupt you really briefly and ask you to state your name for the
record. I'm sorry, Carl Dorr, and I'm a Lisle resident.
And I know you've been sworn in before. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, I have. And the second thing, in listening to the conversation that just took place, I find it interesting that if you take a look at what happened, I believe they said in 2015 with respect to warehouse, and what happened as a result, I'm not saying Amazon is good or bad, but I think it does point out that perhaps more definition, more, has to be more to it than what's been happening in the past with respect to a zoning authority's position with respect to what took place there. So I would encourage that the commission take a good hard look at the differences that can occur and have occurred with respect to warehouse, freight terminals, or whatever it is, a huge difference amongst we could probably talk for 5 hours with respect to what could happen. With respect to that issue, I'd like to go on to the stormwater issue and lot coverage, and stress strongly that lot coverage, in my opinion, impacts bulk regulations, and in addition, it impacts stormwater runoff. Many people think that the only areas in town that are impacted by flooding would be along the river. But they also have to take a look back at what happened in the past, and perhaps this isn't the time to bring this up, but with respect to base flood elevations, there's been a big difference. Whenever they redo the FEMA maps, the flood elevations don't go down, they go up. And I think it was a meeting about 2 years ago, I believe, that FEMA conducted, and they indicated that FEMA is now looking at what impact climate change may have on the modeling that they go through in order to come up with base flood elevation. So I submit that in addition to lot coverage with regard to zoning issues, bulk regulations, I think the stormwater management issue is vital. And for example, from what I understand, I could be wrong, that the county ordinance exempts up to 2,500 square feet of lot coverage. That's fine, but if you continue to add 2,500 square feet, et cetera, you know, pretty soon, and it's happened, you start to see base flood elevation changes. So I'm not criticizing the proposed stormwater management, but I am suggesting that a very good, very hard look has to be taken, especially by the Village of Lisle with respect to county involvement, because most of what we experience in water problems here start many miles from where we're at, and people suffer as a result of what happens. And I suggest that the village suggests very strongly that and get involved in county regulations with respect to runoff, because it impacts us from from what I understand, Western Westmont, Downers Grove, Glen Ellen, Lombard, Naperville, Wheaton. So I don't think we can look at that blindly. With respect to the accessory buildings, I think that's another interesting topic, and I suggest that you probably have taken a good hard look at that, and you will continue to do so. I'd like to compliment the staff for the time they spent on it, and the journey's been long. The ride has gone on for, what, a year and a half or whatever it's been, and I applaud you for sticking with it and listening to people like me give you ideas, and I appreciate what you do. Thank you.
And is there anyone else in the room that would like to give public comment? Okay, Director Smetana, if we have anyone participating online.
Chris Dargis, I'm going to allow you to speak if you'd like to participate.
Do you have anyone else?
That's it, Chairman.
Okay. As that wraps up public comment, I think after the commentary we've heard tonight, I'd like to kind of go backwards to the industrial zoning topic. If Director Smetana could kind of give us an overview of where we started, or basically what we have in our code now, the iterations to where we are today, and kind of give us a summary of what's being proposed in edition number 7 of our draft code, so we can all understand what we've got in front of us and where we need to go from here.
We'll start that in 1 second. Okay, so in the village's current zoning ordinance, warehousing is a permitted use. In the I-1 zoning district, a freight terminal facility is a special use permit. In preparing the original draft proposed zoning code, staff proposed that warehousing be a special use permit in the I-1 zoning district in addition to the freight terminal facility. Staff's logic for this proposal is that it becomes more and more difficult to differentiate between those two uses, and we thought it was appropriate to require a special use permit for both warehousing and freight operations to allow the village the opportunity to carefully review those uses, ensure that the nearby road networks can accommodate the proposed traffic, and ensure that the site can accommodate those uses. As we worked through the public hearing process over the past 9 or so months, we did receive comments from in I-1 zone property owners who wanted us to relax the special use permit requirements on warehouses, but thought that perhaps warehouses over a certain square footage should still be required to obtain a special use permit. So staff revised their proposal and placed a 25,000 square foot threshold on warehousing uses. So if you proposed a warehouse use in the I-1 zoning district and that warehouse was less than 25,000 square feet, the use would be permitted. But if the warehouse was greater than 25,000 square feet, the use would be a special use permit. As we continued through the public hearing process, we received some objections towards that threshold. And in the most recent iteration, which is reflected in this draft 7, was to revise the definitions of both the warehousing use and the freight terminal facility use, and to establish warehousing as a permitted use in the I-1 zoning district, which is consistent with what the current zoning ordinance requirements are.
So I'll ask a quick question. Why is it so hard to tell the difference between warehousing and a freight terminal?
What makes it difficult, at least in staff's perspective, is that even warehouse uses in today's world will have transportation-related activities. So you're going to have trucks coming and going. And what becomes difficult is how to differentiate between a warehouse use and a freight terminal use, because typically warehouse uses in today's world do have a high number of truck trips back and forth. What one might think of a warehouse where goods, materials are just stored in a building for long periods of time, I don't think that use truly exists anymore. I think that there's going to be some transportation or logistics related operations associated with any warehouse.
The previous iteration that proposed the 25,000 square foot sort of cutoff of what would be an allowed warehouse versus a larger than 25,000 square foot would be a special use. One, what was the rationale for the 25,000? And would that be 25,000 as a tenant space within a building, or would that be the size of the entire building with multiple tenants potentially?
The square footage was recommended by Mr. Pritchett, who you heard from tonight, and John Moran, who is another I-1 property owner in the Village of Lisle.
Okay, and then the
so they proposed that square footage.
And then the second part of that being, is that the size of a tenant space in a multi-tenanted building? Or
that was a total floor area in a building.
Of an entire building?
Of an entire building.
Okay. Does anybody else have any questions for staff on this subject? Comment, questions. Yeah, we'll do either one.
I appreciate everyone coming here and talking tonight. I just, for the record for myself, I'm very comfortable with where it is at now. We have two things that I feel that I'm looking at. We have a building, a property owner's business that they have invested in that has been there for, quite some time, and their right to be able to lease that property and use that. And then we have residents on the other side. The idea of trucks coming in and out, well, there's 52-foot trucks going in and out of every restaurant here as well. It's just how things get around. So for me personally, I believe what we have come up with the term difference between what is a freight terminal facility, which I think was written very well, and what a warehouse does, I think that difference is adequate. It speaks both to, I think, residents' concerns, and I think it also speaks to business owners who own properties that are warehouses that are not freight terminals. So my personal opinion on this is that I think we have a good solution currently, and it does not need to revert back to a 25,000 square foot limitation on that. We have other warehouses that are 30. Now the 25,000 square foot property is going to rent much quicker than that 30 because somebody has to now go through a process. So I think it's an uneven playing field. I think a warehouse is a warehouse, and a freight terminal, the definition that staff came up with for that and this board, I think is accurate and can be discerned as a difference maker between the two different uses.
Chairman, I would add, there was some discussion earlier about the village's interpretation of the freight terminal facility use and Amazon. I would add that in this draft zoning code proposal, staff has attempted to clarify what a freight terminal facility is. And in doing so, the term parcel delivery services was added to the definition. Parcel delivery services is really what Amazon or DHL is doing. So we try to better capture those type of uses within the freight terminal facility definition to avoid a misinterpretation in the future.
Do any of the other commissioners have any comments or questions? Nothing? Commissioner Bauer, since you're far away.
I don't. I agree with Commissioner Trussell's remarks.
I guess I'll ask staff one more question. The suggestion that was made tonight about performance standards for warehouses with regards to a site plan, traffic, and noise, Is there currently in the draft any, in the draft zoning code, any type of performance standards that would address those things? I.e. submission of a site plan or a traffic plan or an evaluation of the noise that would be generated by a warehouse operation, like to get a certificate of occupancy?
So with any occupancy permit application or a commercial remodel permit application, an applicant is required to submit a site plan that reflects the property so that we can determine if there's an appropriate number of parking spaces, access aisles on the property. As far as traffic study is concerned, we do have a provision in this draft zoning code that gives some authority for a traffic study to be requested. I think we may have to look at that provision and make sure that it's applicable to a use that's a permitted use.
And give it an option for...
Give it some teeth so that we could apply that to a permitted use, not a use that's going through a special use permit process or a planned unit development process.
Is perhaps a trigger for a higher level of scrutiny for something that could have...
Correct.
So one other question. One of the other speakers tonight talked about DuPage County's regulations with warehouses being on major roads versus what I would consider Western Court, not a major road. Is there a way through zoning to limit industrial traffic from use of residential streets? Or is that something that is more of a non-zoning matter?
I feel that that's a non-zoning matter, mm-hmm. matter, but one that could be taken up by the Village Board through the Village's street regulations.
So if this particular office park has been, as has been pointed out by the speakers tonight, has been wrought with problems, partly because it abuts a single family neighborhood and the compatibility issue is a problem. But if there was a restriction that the industrial users basic or trucks simply can't use.
I think it would be a weight limit restriction, and there may already be a weight limit restriction mm-hmm. on trucks leaving that development going east towards the residential homes.
Is that effective?
I believe so. Don't quote me. I'd have to double check that. But I do recall that conversation coming up when the Village was discussing Western Court and possible changes to that court. So I can look into that.
So the vehicle, regular vehicles, which would not necessarily be affiliated with, you know, a freight terminal or warehouse, could still be free to use the residential streets, but then it obviously has its own...
A weight restriction would keep trucks
would keep
off
the trucks or vans, maybe delivery vans, no?
Depends what the weight restriction is.
No.
Probably not.
Yeah.
So in the draft zoning code, section 5-1512 establishes some requirements for traffic studies. It gives the zoning administrator the ability to request trip generation data for any proposed use or development. It gives the zoning administrator and any review and decision-making body, so that would be this commission or the Village Board, the ability to request a traffic study prepared by an Illinois licensed professional traffic operations engineer for any proposed use or development that generates 250 or more average daily weekday trips. So that's a provision that's not in the current zoning code, but would give both Village staff, this commission and the Village Board a little bit more leverage to require traffic studies if there's proposed uses that have high trip generation.
And so that would apply to permitted uses as well?
Correct.
As a basically a condition of getting a certificate of occupancy.
That section also allows the zoning administrator, this commission and the Village Board to require any use or development to provide a vehicle circulation and stacking details that would get to the questions regarding the truck's ability to maneuver on Western Avenue and Western Court.
Okay, so from an adjoining property owner perspective, I see all of this as the zoning administrator may may, not required to provide, but you may request it. Right. So would an adjoining property owner have the right to come in and basically, I'm going to use the word appeal because I'm not really sure whether the word appeal a decision by the zoning administrator that he decides not to seek it. So you decide, nah, it looks good enough. I think it'll be fine. Could an adjoining property owner file an appeal to challenge your decision and say, no, we want a traffic study?
I believe they could. I think in doing so, that appeal will go before this commission. This commission may request that same information, but it would have to be shown that the trip generation exceeds the threshold established in the code, which is that 250 average daily trips.
Well, if it was a proposed development, the trip generation would be basically somebody's word, right?
I mean, this could be an applicant. It would be submitted by the applicant.
Applicant says, no, it'll be 240.
It would be submitted by the applicant. It's typically from a manual.
Okay.
So you can verify that data.
Sort of.
Trip generation manual, you can look up and see average trips for certain types of uses. If you're worried about someone getting around the provision, the simple solution is to change may to shall.
Mm-hmm. And
then applicants would be required to submit that information and do that traffic study.
Or may to shall when it's in the industrial district. You can use your may for any
use. You could remove that
use.
Flexibility for industrial districts and say that they shall.
And then the others are subjected to the zoning administrator's discretion. So say it's something on Ogden Avenue that's commercial but large, and you feel like maybe there's some issues here, but it meets the zoning. But with the industrial, it would provide a mechanism for adjoining property owners to have more oversight, but at the same time, skips the special use requirement for someone to bring in a warehouse. So kind of a halfway in between thing.
Yep.
I really want to hear your public comment on that kind of idea. If you think it helps the situation or hurts.
Michael Roth again.
Yes.
It does help the situation. Two points about the discussion there. One is, I think the question to Mike was, is there a zoning mechanism to deal with this issue, or how do you enforce? How do you place restrictions like that through zoning? And the answer is through special uses. You don't do it by way of truck routing, although truck routing is an important regulatory mm-hmm. method, but the way you place restrictions through zoning is conditional uses, place conditions. That's the right way to do it. And then it runs with the land, and it's effective, it's enforceable. The second point that I wanted to make is, while the traffic study is a step forward, and it is a good one, how do you apply that to a permitted use? So as the attorney for a property owner comes up and says, hey, my use is permitted, we have a right to operate. What do you do with the staff's decision with regards to a traffic study? If they find through the traffic study that the site or the plans for the improvement of the site are insufficient to deal with traffic conditions, street grids, et cetera, surrounding properties, what do you do then? Are you saying that we then tell him after he's got his zoning and he comes in for his occupancy permit, I don't think that's the way to do it. I think the best way to do it in a reasonably balanced way is the special use. But to your answer your question, it is kind of a half step forward.
I agree with Mr. Roth. It's either a permitted use or it's not. And permitted uses, the property owner can utilize them. With respect to other communities, I know a lot of communities will require new users coming in to apply for a business license. Mm-hmm. They have to fully describe the land use that permits the zoning staff to classify the use as either fitting within the freight terminal land use that you want to have as a conditional use, or fitting within the warehousing use. As it relates to something other than the use, which is simply the traffic generated by the land use. The question then becomes, is the traffic generated by a 159,000 square foot office building that also has service spaces within it going to generate in excess of 250 traffic movements on a daily basis? In which case, every time they change tenants at that particular facility for Mr. Pritchett, is he going to then have to produce traffic movement studies and go through this entire process? The good news is, as the village, you control your own right-of-way. So I have numerous villages that have regulated right-of-way where if they decide that they don't want trucks on a particular route, they prohibit it and post signs and allow those truck users to be ticketed at those locations. So the village has all the authority in the world to manage the traffic routing in and out of this particular industrial park as the challenges occur and as traffic changes from time to time. So Mr. Roth and I agree, it's either a permitted use or it's a non-permitted use. And once you fit into the category where you have to pass through a series of tests with the village in order to get any use associated with the building, you're in a category that's different than the surrounding communities.
Yes. Come on up to the dais.
Microphones have gone out. Okay, yeah. With regard to changing the language to shall require those things, if it's a permitted use, I don't think you can do that unless you also set up some performance standards to do that so that they know what it is they're supposed to be showing. I know staff did review the concept of performance standards and elected not to incorporate that into the zoning code, but if that is an effective tool for this particular situation, you may want to look at that. Also, with regard, there's been a fair amount of discussion about truck trafficking. Yes, the village can establish truck routes, can prohibit certain weights, but keep in mind, they can't totally prohibit truck traffic. They have to have a way in and out. The truck route state statute allows you to get to the point, either to your point of delivery or your point of return, even if it's not on a truck route, if you can prove that that's what you're doing. Now, for example, the situation where we've had all the problems, they can prohibit truck traffic on Middleton because there's another way to get to where they're going. But you have to allow at least one way, is what I wanted to clarify.
And I think it is important to remember that really all of this discussion, almost an hour of tonight's meeting, is based on something that happened.
Yeah.
One thing that happened in the past that's no longer in operation.
Well, and it's one conversation of many that have happened, and it's challenging, right? Because you, it's a challenging issue. I mean, as it stands, as part of this overall greater effort of writing a zoning code, I tend to agree with Commissioner Trussell that in this broad look of reorganizing the zoning code, making very substantial changes is not appropriate at this time. And if the village board wants to make more substantial changes, I think these things should come through as single item changes to the zoning code. Once we've reestablished a new format and streamlined the code, which was the essential goal of this now almost 2-year process. So as it's written in here now, and you know, incorporating the comments from the village attorney, and we will probably talk about performance standards later, tonight if possible. I mean, I think we've got mechanisms in here. I know one of the comments tonight did address and is always available to an adjoining property owner is in fact to sue. I do understand that that's an expensive alternative, but it's real. When one looks at the issues of the past, it was a very viable option. I'm not saying or advocating that people should come and sue the village. It would not be my job to do that. But I do understand the rights of adjoining property owners. I respect them, and I do understand that they have these rights. And if the village does not enforce, certainly the neighbors with standing within a certain distance have under state law the ability to go in and do this. And that's not being removed from anybody. So if for some reason these same mistakes are made and some unfortunate thing happens and we have a different, you know, director who has a different opinion and we see the mistakes being made again, those avenues still do exist. So given all of that, I'm most comfortable with where we are today. I understand it's not going to please everybody. It's not written in stone forever, and it's obviously just a recommendation from this board that goes to the village board. And who knows how long this process will be with the village board. It could be another year, who knows. And they too could come back and make isolated changes. You know, it's not a fixed document. It will change over time, as we've all learned that, you know, uses change. So that being said, if anybody else has any comments on the industrial, I'd like to move on to a few other chapters, if that's possible. Everybody comfortable moving on, or does anyone else have anything else to add? Okay, good. Chapters that we have not at all talked about since we've started this process is chapters 13 through 16. Chapter 13, let's just go in order. I could reorder it, but I think we might as well just go in order. Chapter 13 is off-street parking. I'd like to ask Director Smetana if he could give us a overview of the proposed changes relative to what we currently have in our code today for Chapter 13 off-street parking.
Okay, so Chapter 13 covers the village's off-street parking requirements. Some of the steps that village staff took in preparing this chapter was we rearranged the parking ratios so that the ratios were both consistent with current uses as defined in this zoning code and based on 1,000 square feet of floor area. We revised parking stall dimension requirements to be more reflective of modern standards.
Meaning you made them smaller?
We made them smaller.
Okay.
Let me find our other summaries real quick.
Sure.
We provide some flexibility to staff so that when there's a use that's being proposed that's not delineated within the chapter, staff can refer to the Institute of Transportation Engineers or the American Planning Association to determine appropriate parking ratios for that use. We reduced the on-street parking credit for downtown businesses to a 1-to-1 ratio. Currently, for every one on-street parking space, the business gets a credit of 4 spaces. We don't think that's necessarily appropriate. We believe it should be 1-to-1. Now, with that being said, we also eliminated parking, off-street parking requirements for all downtown businesses. The only uses in the downtown that will require, be required to provide off-street parking are residential uses and medical uses. So if a restaurant comes forward or a retail business will no longer be looking at how much off-street parking they cannot provide on their site and requiring them to go through a variance process. I think that's a big step. I think that that helps businesses move forward in the downtown. If you recall, we just had a beauty shop that had to get a variance for no parking spaces. That's common in a downtown and appropriate. So that's a proposal that, that staff believes is an important step for downtown businesses. We also established some bicycle parking requirements in the off-street parking chapter. And we revised standards for residential districts to simplify and streamline restrictions on both the number of vehicles that could be parked outside, commercial vehicles, and recreational vehicles in residential districts. That's my high-level summary, Chairman.
Okay, do any of the commissioners have any comments or questions for staff or general comments on Chapter 13, off-street parking? I'll start with Commissioner Biederstadt. Do you have any questions? Not that you won't have a chance again. I'm just going to try to prompt people.
It's been a while, but in reviewing my notes, I had made a note concerning off-street parking standards on pages 151 and 152. I didn't know if there was any departures from the current code or anything that is substantively being changed.
What section is this again?
What?
513. But yeah, 513.
Oh, exemptions and credits.
Over and above what obviously you've already stated.
So again, the change in the credit is a change from how we currently credit parking in the downtown. But the bigger change is that we will no longer require off-street parking for downtown uses other than residential and medical. Another change from the current zoning code to what's proposed now is that we still do allow for shared parking agreements. Those shared parking agreements are subject to village staff approval, where currently those have to be brought forward to the Planning and Zoning Commission for approval.
Commissioner Trussell?
I mean, this is a weird one, Mike. We don't allow sexually oriented businesses in Lisle?
We do.
We do? Can you give me a definition of that?
Yes. Well, it's about a page long.
Oh, great.
But they are special. They're all special
uses. We do allow them. They are special use. I will tell you that the way that the village regulates that use, there is very limited opportunity to establish the use in the village. So you can't have an outright prohibition of the use, but most jurisdictions will establish setbacks and other requirements that significantly reduce the available area for that use to be conducted.
Like setbacks from schools and things like that, right?
All right. So the number 5 on the parking per 1,000 square feet, I guess, is what it is. Thank you.
That's it? Well. Okay.
If I may, I was reviewing some of my notes from prior to Mr. Smetana on 5-13-9 for off-street loading. Some of my prior notes that I had mentioned or that I'm referring to, I had a question that I had noted. Should we consider a reasonable hour limitation or noise level or anything to protect any residential areas? That was the last question that I had regarding this within my notes.
I think we may be able to address that comment with our discussion regarding performance standards later tonight.
Commissioner Nakamura, you have anything?
Yeah, I just have a question regarding the actual bicycle parking. I haven't seen too much of bicycle parking for any new development. How enforceable has the village been with asking for bicycle parking for a new development?
Well, the current zoning code doesn't require bicycle parking. So this would be a new requirement in the village for businesses to provide a location for folks to store their bicycles.
And then what if there's no space really provide the bicycle parking? Can they put it inside your facility or else how does that work?
That could be an alternative. I think the goal is to encourage businesses to at least provide that opportunity so the bicycles can be stored out of pedestrians' way, not in the parking lot.
Okay. And then do you take it to another level where I have seen some codes where you provide bicycle parking, but then you need to provide a changing room or showers for...
No.
Okay. So, all right. Okay. All right. Thank you.
Commissioner Bauer, do you have any questions or comments on the off-street parking?
I have one question concerning, I'm looking at two computer monitors as I'm speaking because I don't have the benefit of my notes given where I'm located at the time. But Mike, with respect to the downtown business district and the modification to 513-6 that you spoke of regarding credit for on-street parking. And then while I can't find it now, I recall your indications that downtown business uses do not need to provide on-site parking given the infeasibility of that occurring under current site conditions. We still have, or we will still have a requirement that those businesses have to provide what would otherwise be on-site parking within the village's municipal parking lot by way of parking permit passes, correct?
So the village doesn't technically require that right now. We do, as a condition of special use permits, require that, but that's not a requirement of permitted uses in the downtown. It's an option and it's encouraged, but it's not a requirement. I suppose the village enforces that by writing tickets if employees of those businesses are parked on Main Street for more than the specified time period allowed.
Understood. I guess I'm just thinking, rather than being reactive by issuing parking tickets, can we be proactive in requiring those uses to provide parking via the village's municipal lot that can't otherwise be supplied on site? I mean, when it comes to, for example, on-street parking, obviously there are a number of uses competing for that on-street parking supply. So just as a practical matter, hopefully as, more downtown spaces become occupied and there becomes a greater parking demand, I'm just wondering how feasible it is for that to, for on-street parking supply alone to suffice in the absence of not also then requiring those downtown uses to, secure by way of parking passes, parking supply in the municipal lot.
I think it's a good thought. I'm not sure if it's a zoning ordinance requirement or a broader policy decision by the village.
I just had a similar conversation with the village manager about this issue of business owners and employees taking up on-street parking spaces. There are enforcement mechanisms that you can use to deal with that. I mean, otherwise you're going back to requiring businesses to have so many, you know, off-street parking spaces available for, you know, obviously we would encourage them to use that for staff rather than customers, but we can't specify the municipal lot. What it would have to be is off-street parking. I mean, if they wanted to rent it from some private owner, they could do that, but I don't know if you want to completely revisit the idea of not having the parking requirements, because it is pretty common in dense downtown areas to not have an on-site parking requirement, and generally it's enforcement, you know, setting up time limits and then enforcing it to encourage the staff and the owners to move from the prime spaces somewhere that are timed to somewhere else.
So what is the time on the downtown B3A area for on-street parking? What's the time limit?
I don't know.
I think it's 3 hours.
Is it? Okay. They can always shorten that.
That's kind of what I was thinking, because...
Yeah, the manager's aware of the issue, and he's looking at it.
Yeah, I'm kind of thinking with the way that it's handled in downtown Naperville, right? So they make the accommodation where there's certain spots where you can park for 8 hours, and that's where all the employees have to park, and you get a sticker that says you're a downtown employee, and you get a sticker on your car, and you can park there for 8, 12 hours or whatever. But everybody else has got time limits, even if the parking is free, right?
I misspoke. It's 2 hours in the village code. There's a few 15-minute parking spaces in front of certain addresses to facilitate carry out and pick up.
I'm not sure it's businesses. A zoning. I'm not sure that it's something that would really be part of the zoning code, or more of a recommendation from this body to address the change we're making to remove that burden from permitted businesses, but that it should be simultaneously accompanied by some sort of revision at the village board level that's not part of a zoning code. And aside, you know, we would just recommend that they would compensate for what we're recommending with some non-zoning regulations. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and as I said, that even before you get your recommendation out, the manager's already looking at it, so.
Good. He's probably watching tonight. Does anyone else have any questions? Commissioner Bauer, are you done? Do you have anything else?
That's it for now. Thanks.
Okay, I have a couple questions. First of all, we have the nice table of parking with spots per thousand and all. Do any of these increase the parking requirements for any uses, making the parking burden heavier than what we have now? Other than roundup error?
Yeah, I think that if we were to really do an analysis, there might be some that may be rounded up slightly, especially once you start getting into larger buildings because of our adjustment of the scale. You know, the current zoning code is difficult in that it's one use will be four spaces per every 300 square feet, and the next use will be four spaces per every 500 square feet. So we really wanted to make it consistent. That helps with administration of the code and enforcement of the code. So there might have been some slight upticks because of that change in the ratio. But other than that, staff did not, you know, drastically change the base number of parking spaces required for each use.
Okay. I'm looking at section 513.5, which is a table that begins with residential, two parking spaces for each unit. And this would apply to multifamily and for residential within mixed use, two spots per unit.
That's correct, and that is a adjustment of what the current code requirement is, which is between one, one and a half, depending on the number of bedrooms per unit. And quite frankly, that's based on us learning that apartments and mixed-use developments, particularly at least in the Lisle market, they're usually not transportation-oriented developments. Those folks still have cars, typically two cars per unit, and they still rely on their vehicles. So we want to make sure that as new multifamily developments occur in the downtown, that there is adequate parking for those developments.
Okay, and then the existing multifamily would be, that has less than two would be?
It would be grandfathered, that'd be a non-conforming.
With the change in parking spot size, can a property owner restripe their lot without going through any kind of procedure?
They would need a permit to restripe it.
And then it's just a formality, like a building permit?
Correct.
They don't have to come in and seek a variance, and then we've eliminated all of that process for, say, you know, the large office buildings that are trying to cram in more than 3.3.
Unless it was a specific condition of village board approval.
Oh, on their original PUD?
Correct.
Okay.
If it wasn't specifically identified, I would be comfortable allowing them to come forward under the current zoning code and restripe
to smaller spots to fit more parking, and again, like alleviating a step.
Yes.
Okay, good. I think that's important because I think it's kind of a tedious thing that never gets denied. The provision for guest parking spaces, again, this is in section 513.5. The part that I'm kind of confused about here is the reductions to guest parking spaces considered on a case-by-case basis, subject to approval by the zoning administrator if warranted, and then A and B provision where you've already provided more than two, so then therefore it gives you some sort of credit for guest parking. But then B, which seems extremely vague to me, other unique characteristics which warrant a reduced level of guest parking. So this whole section seems a little vague, and I'm not even sure if the reduction would then require a variance.
With how this is written, the reduction would not require a variance if they complied with A or B. So I think that with A, what it's getting at is perhaps the guest parking can actually be compensated for in just the allowable number of parking spaces on the driveway. So a specific guest parking spot isn't called out separately. I think that's an example of A. With B, I've seen townhome developments where parking spaces are actually provided off the street, mm-hmm. in almost like how our downtown parking is, kind of a curbed-in section of the road where there's pull-in parking spaces. I think that that's an example of how someone could qualify under the exemption established by B, is that you have parking spaces provided as part of an association outlot or part of the right-of-way that compensates for guest parking throughout that development, at least in that area of the development.
So does the guest parking requirement, 0.25, only applies to duplexes and townhouses, like an R3? Or do we have guest parking requirements for multifamily?
That should be clarified. It should be for multifamily too.
So I guess then, you know, I guess it's a question of how much of a reduction? Is there any kind of limitation, or is it all subjective to?
It's fairly subjective as written.
So 0.25 per unit. So if you had a 200 unit building, you'd be looking at 50 guest parking spots. And
yeah.
Then a reduction could be to zero arbitrarily without a variance, without.
We could establish a threshold or just remove the reduction allowance altogether.
Well, I guess I'm not uncomfortable with a small reduction through this process, but I would be hesitant to have, you know, from whatever's required to zero.
25% of the requirement?
Yeah, something like that.
Okay.
Like, and then anything you want more than that would have to go through some sort of variance procedure. Does that seem reasonable?
Yes.
So I just have a question regarding the parking as well in regards to, can you park your vehicles on a driveway if it's long enough to satisfy the parking requirements?
Yes, so when you look at required parking for residential uses, it's not specifying whether that's in a garage or on a driveway. So in theory, with a townhome or duplex where you need two parking spaces, if you have a two-car attached garage, you've already met that minimum parking requirement.
Okay, and what if in the case of a business where it requires three or four parking spaces and you have a driveway long enough, could that be credited that you could park on the driveway as opposed to having specific area for parking, you know, creating a parking stall?
So when you say driveway, you're implying a commercial driveway?
I'm implying a private driveway leading to a commercial business, maybe.
But not a house, not like a home occupation?
No.
Okay. So I think that in that situation, staff would probably review those parking spaces as permitted, but they're going to have to meet the parallel parking requirements of the zoning code. And that has a little bit larger dimensions to ensure that folks can get in and out of those spaces. Okay. And then we would have to look at the driveway and the space that's remaining after those parallel parking spaces are delineated for fire access.
I see. Okay. Okay.
Because that would be a fire access lane.
As well.
As
sure.
Well.
Okay. So if there is private vehicles parked on the driveway and a fire breaks out, then we need to make sure that a fire engine could also pass by those.
Correct.
Those vehicles that are parked on that particular driveway.
Yes.
Leading up to the facility or the building structure. Okay. Got it. Okay. Thank you.
A few more questions. The group living requirement of 0.5, is that something, 0.5 per bed, is that a parking requirement that we currently have, or is this new?
That's a good question. I'll have to look that up.
And from where, if it's new, where did it come from? Because 0.5 per bed, it seems like you would need more than that, and then...
I think the assumption
is that parking as well.
I think the assumption is that every occupant of that group home would not have a car or visitor at the same time.
What about taking into consideration staff?
Yeah, staff.
Visitors?
I think the parking is mostly for staff. Generally, these assisted living facilities, the
group living,
the occupants don't drive from all the ones that I've seen.
I think maybe
they have to provide transportation. Staff generally provides the transportation if they have to go somewhere.
Do we have any experience with any kind of group homes that we have now in Lisle that are problematic with regard to this, or no?
I don't recall complaints regarding parking. I mean, you have to remember that the village does not require overnight parking on any street. So in a sense, I mean, we're establishing a minimum off street. But if it overspills into the roadway, that's going to be a problem, and they're going to get tickets for being parked in the roadway, especially overnight. So while this is a minimum standard, that's not stopping businesses and uses from having more than what our minimum standard is. We don't want to regulate and require too much parking because that can be an issue too. Where you have vast empty parking lots that are designed for the one peak day of need.
Can you just refresh me? Group living is permitted in what? Every zone, correct? Residential, everything else, is that correct?
Single family.
Yeah.
With spacing requirements, I believe.
I mean, I guess I would maybe ask staff to just take another quick look at that. Group living normally has multiple workers there, and depending on how many beds are available, I think this may be a little bit, you're bringing up a good point. I mean, you know, you got
10 beds, that's five spots, that's probably good. You have five beds, you have 2.5 spots, that's probably not sufficient, right? From a minimum parking. Maybe staff could just take some consideration of the different zones that this is permitted in and whether or not this is speaking to any potential issues that you may see for that. It strikes me as being insufficient, I think, from my understanding of what group living properties partake under or do.
So what staff will do, we can take a look at surrounding jurisdictions. We'll also take a look at the American Planning Association manual that we reference. What that manual does is it takes uses and gives and publishes a range of parking requirements found across the country for those uses. So you can kind of see the range that everyone falls in, and that'll give us a good guide as to where we're at with our requirement.
Yeah, maybe it's not that all group housing or community residents are treated the same, because I could easily see where something that's assisted living might be very true that most of the residents don't drive, but if it was something along the lines of student housing or something, you might find a lot more cars.
And remember that almost all the group living uses are a special use. So there's already village oversight where we're going to be able to take a closer look at parking.
Okay. I think just to follow up and let us know what you find would be great. And my last one is the last part is 5.13.10, limit on number of motor vehicles parked in a residential district. The proposed section here says that no more than 5 motor vehicles owned or controlled by the owner or occupant of the property may be parked outside of an enclosed building in R1, R2, R3, and R4. And all motor vehicles parked outside of an enclosed building in these districts must be parked on a driveway. So I think the first part of this is whether this should just be R1 and R2. Obviously, in R4, I'm not thinking we're parking on driveways. We might be parking in a parking lot if we're outside. R3 being townhouses could be any kind of combination of driveways or parking lots. And the number 5 doesn't necessarily make a lot of sense for R3 and R4. So I think that this section needs a little tweaking about, where we're parking 5 vehicles.
Staff agrees it should only apply to R1, R2.
Okay. So then the next section is part 2. No more than 1 commercial vehicle with a gross weight of not more than 5,000 or 8,000 pounds owned and controlled by the owner or the occupant of the subject property may be parked outside in R1, R2, R3, R4. So again, I guess the question is this really the districts we want to be talking about? R3 and R4, how many commercial vehicles would you end up in a parking lot if you had 1 per unit? I'm assuming that in R1 and R2, this is 1 of the 5 limited in item 1 above. So you have 5 vehicles, 1 of which might be a commercial vehicle?
It would be 1 of the 5.
Okay.
Current village code is 10,000 pounds, so we're dropping it to 8,000.
So by way of description, what does that eliminate then?
So in the question...
I'm not a car expert.
When the question of vehicle weight comes up, what I typically rely on is the Secretary of State's website and license plate classifications. That's usually a good start because you can see what a license plate authorizes a vehicle to be. Okay. I will tell you that we had an issue of a school bus being parked in a residential area in Lisle. That school bus may or may not meet the 10,000 pound limit. It's on the cusp, so 10,000 pounds can be pretty big. It's a shorter school bus, but we thought it'd be best to drop it to 8,000. I've seen 8,000 used in other jurisdictions.
They use 8,000 because that's the maximum weight for a Class B truck.
Okay, so that would be...
Driver license. It's easy to enforce because, you know, if you've got a C or a D commercial, you're going to be over.
You can identify the weight by the license plate.
Correct.
So you don't have to guess the weight.
Correct.
The problem with the school buses, they aren't classified as commercial, so that, you know, then you have to figure out the weight. But in general, it's going to assist in enforcement.
Okay, that's good. And I don't know about the enforcement of the, then on R3 and R4. Like, does this, how does this work there? I mean, do you want one commercial vehicle per unit, or is this something that that we even want to regulate, I guess? I'll just say that.
Well...
What do we do now?
What do we do now?
In R3 and R4. I mean, do we go on an apartment parking lot and drive around and figure out how many commercial vehicles are parked in,
right,
say, lakeside apartments or something?
This is a provision that's largely complaint...
Complaint-based.
...based. I mean, it's a sensitive issue. There are folks who...
It's their main vehicle.
And it's their livelihood.
Right.
They may need to bring home a work truck. So this is not one that I would say village staff goes out looking for,
mm-hmm,
but it's one that's often regulated by a village to ensure that you don't have a semi-tractor or other large commercial
vehicle parked in
a residential neighborhood.
Right. And then this way it can be enforced by more than the property owner itself.
But the 8,000-pound cutoff will ensure that folks kind of have, like, your traditional fleet vehicle,
mm-hmm,
say a van that a plumber uses, or, I mean, those will meet that definition and be allowed. And you have to recognize that people do use vehicles for work and provide some flexibility.
Yes, and I know that there are other restrictions within subdivisions and HOAs that would provide that those have to be in a garage. But that's outside of the village's purview. But those more stringent requirements, I certainly know, do exist. Commercial vehicles with lettering. So the last one is really where I'm going here, is number three, no more than one recreational vehicle owned or controlled by the owner of an occupant of the subject property may be parked outside in the R1, R2, R3, and R4 districts. Again, I'm assuming that a recreational vehicle is one of the five in item one above, and this wouldn't be an addition to five vehicles. It would be one of the five vehicles.
That's correct, one of the five.
And then the recreational vehicle would not necessarily just be a vehicle. It could be a trailer. I mean, there's recreation like a tow along or a boat or someone using a trailer for wave runners or something.
Correct.
I mean, these are all recreational vehicles, right?
Correct. The draft code defines a recreational vehicle as a travel trailer, camping trailer, truck camper, camper shell, motorhome, tent trailer, boat, houseboat, boat trailer, snowmobile, personal watercraft, or similar vehicle. So it's pretty all-inclusive.
So my thought on this particular one item is that it's relaxing what's in our current code. And I...
To a certain degree.
Yes, it is relaxing what's in our current code. So if we look at section 517.7 in our current code, we do allow recreational vehicles to be parked on a residential lot. I'm assuming this is with respect to R1, R2 in our current code, not R3 and R4. But there's restrictions on the length of a recreational vehicle being 25 feet long, if it's in the front or corner side yard of a property, setbacks of 5 feet. I'm inclined to think that the additional limitations that we have in the code today should be carried forward and incorporated into the new code. My thought is that, you know, we're looking at putting in enhanced architectural standards for residential neighborhoods. We're looking at trying to improve the overall aesthetic of not only R1 and R2, but things like Ogden Avenue, and rolling back the recreational vehicle parking, especially within front and side yards or visibility from the street, would seem to work against the goal of trying to improve the overall visual and aesthetic of the neighborhoods with the other things we're changing. And it all should work to the same end, to improve the overall appearance. And I don't really think we should roll any of it back, and it should just maintain the status quo and provide the same requirements and the same flexibility. I mean, it's not like we're removing the ability to park a recreational vehicle. It's just that it comes with some consideration with regard to front and side corners in terms of how it appears, not only to the neighbors, but just to the community overall.
Could we meet halfway and bring over the setback and size requirements, but not bring over requirements that, you know, it'd actually be the property owner who owns the RV?
Oh, I don't know that it matters who owns it.
Under the current code, it does.
Okay.
So we want to ditch some of the items there.
I don't think it matters who owns it.
So we'll bring over the setback requirements and size limitations.
The 25 feet, the 5 feet. Right. So I'm looking at 517.7 section, subsection B. And there's 4 points in there with regards to these restrictions that were adopted some time ago.
You can bring those all over.
I think this would be. And then, of course, obviously, as we move a recommendation forward, I don't know if everybody here agrees with my thoughts on this, but obviously the village board can decide to flip this back and loosen it up if they like to. So if anybody else has any comments on the RVs, please jump in.
For the record, I'm in support of what you said or suggested.
Anyone else?
Yeah, I guess mine kind of flows together here. So Mike, number one, 5 motor vehicles on a driveway, yet there's no stipulation on how big that driveway needs to be.
No.
And an RV, one could say an 8,000-pound vehicle is counting as one vehicle on a driveway when it could certainly take up the space of 2 vehicles.
Could.
Correct. So I don't know if there's some way to, if other municipalities have a square footage calculation for driveway to say, hey, this is the rule for parking. Somebody complains.
So what this code is really designed to do is prevent folks from more or less hoarding vehicles on their property.
Understood.
It's not really, that's what it's used for.
I understand.
I don't know that we want to ever get into regulating to ensure that the driveway is big enough to accommodate 5. We're just saying you can't have more than 5. There's already other village codes in place that say you can't park the sidewalk, across the sidewalk. You can't park in the road. You can't park on your front yard. So
if your driveway only fits 2 cars,
then you're only having 2 cars.
You're not going to stack them? We
would allow up to 5, but it's really going to be what your property and your driveway can accommodate.
Right. So if my property could accommodate 7.
You're not going to have 7. You're only going to have 5.
In lieu of the questions being asked, can you explain what happens when you receive a complaint and how that process plays itself out?
Sure. Village goes out and counts cars. Typically, when there's more than 5 cars, there are also cars that are not registered or operable, and those are 2 more violations of the village code.
I'm assuming that tickets are issued, some sort of fine?
Yes.
Okay.
All of the above.
Or people move their cars. Right. All right. Do we have any other comments on Chapter 13? Okay, we're getting like 10 to 9, so we'll see if we can do Chapter 14. Let me find my page here. Chapter 14 is, if I remember correct, wireless communication facilities.
Correct.
So if you could just give us a quick overview, Director Smentana, on what we've changed here from what we have currently.
We reorganized the chapter. We really did not change any provisions of the current wireless regulations for the village. Our regulations have been written pretty recently by village attorneys, and we have not had problems with enforcement, so we're leaving that alone.
Okay, so anybody have comments?
Yeah, the only thing, and this is, and I did not notate any issues with this section. The only thing that I did point out that would have been valuable, or that I questioned, was we don't have a definition of a small wireless facility, and it's referred to through the chapters.
Of a what?
It is defined in state law.
Okay, is there...
So we could refer to that state law section.
Yeah, I mean, just from, you know, what constitutes a small wireless facility.
Right.
There's a big range, if I recall, for that.
Yeah, it is defined in state law.
But it's defined in here.
Yeah, we define it.
It's on page 232, small wireless facility. It's in here.
232?
Page 232. It probably repeats the state definition.
I'm looking at page 158, so I don't know how you get to 232.
Well, the definitions are all in the back.
Oh, so that's referred to in the back as a definition.
It's the state statute definition.
Okay.
And then small wireless is not under the control of zoning.
All right. One second while I look at the definition.
For what it's worth, I had the same comment, Commissioner Tressel.
Thank you.
Okay, does anybody else have anything else on small wireless?
While we're kind of sorting through and looking at the definitions, Mike, I wanted to ask 514-1 right in the beginning. Specifically number 4, it states to accommodate the growing need. I kind of wanted you to speak to, if we're trying to put a code in place for the next 20 plus years, do we need to reference throughout this chapter growing need and some of the other kind of words that may not apply as we move forward?
Those purposes were prepared by the village attorney, not the current one, but the previous one. And so staff left them alone. There's probably references made in Illinois state statute similar to the purposes we identify.
Some of the other comments that I had as I'm looking through my notes. Next section, 514-2, specifically number 1, I wanted to inquire why there was an exemption for village properties as opposed to all others.
Two reasons. That typically implies water towers, and that is a desirable location to place antennas, because it doesn't impact existing businesses or residences, because it's avoiding construction of a new tower. And two is the village collects rent for those locations.
Understood. Moving forward with just some of my notes, 514-4, number 2, you have different uses that are listed in priority. I had in my notes that we might want to add a catch-all at the end of that, just to give some flexibility. Specifically, I had written down if we included L, any other relevant factor which may be reasonable based upon the circumstances.
I would want to review that against state statute and make sure that what we listed is not pulling straight from statute.
Okay.
We are extremely limited on what we can do as a result of the state law regarding regulating those kind of things. But we'll double check to see if we're limited by state law.
I'm by no means an expert on wireless facilities. But,
another unfunded mandate.
It was just some of the notes I had. If anybody else wants to dive in, I'll keep reviewing what I have.
I do have one more comment. It's more of a question. And this is section 514-7, 1A. One actually refers to 180 days constituting an abandonment of a wireless telecommunication facility. And again, on the small wireless one, that it can go for a year prior to saying that it's a bed.
That's from state statute.
That's in the state statute as well.
Yep.
Wonderful.
It's not uncommon when there's a technology that may be overregulated, that the states step in to kind of hold back villages so that.
Yeah, I'm just looking at it from technology growing. I mean, wireless may, I don't know how it would be, but the whole delivery system of that could change where these things are sitting all over the place. So I was just asking a question of why we, obviously we did not pick the 12 months, that's a state, so thank you.
Well, I mean, we can't, I mean, the village, we still can't regulate by zoning small wireless facilities, right? I mean, that hasn't changed. We don't regulate, we can't, by zoning.
That has not changed.
Okay. As much as people would like it to change.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay, does anyone else have anything else for wireless facilities, chapter 14? Oh, you want to say something? Just come, you have to come all the way down. I'm so sorry, sit closer to the front next time, Ms. Bartelli.
I have an issue.
You have an issue, do you think we can hear you if you're all the way back there?
Yeah, I just wanted to know if the abandonment of wireless facilities means the satellite dishes that you see that people changed and they didn't take down the dishes and see them kind of like they're not in use anymore, does it cover that?
No.
No. No, these are wireless, not satellite dishes.
Isn't that a wireless?
No.
We're talking about commercial uses.
You're referring to satellite dishes on homes?
By telecom companies.
Yeah, people like telecom companies, they have satellite dishes all over the place, and somebody moved them, they are no longer operating, you know, they're abandoned.
Okay, so because she's way in the back, I'm just going to repeat that her concern was satellite dishes and whether or not this is applicable to wireless facilities, but these wireless facilities are really, you know, basically cell phone towers, for lack of a better word, and not satellite dishes that, you know, residents or residential complexes would put on buildings for cable TV, for example. That's kind of what you're thinking, right?
Yeah, but I thought
No, it's not the same. No, I think that the cable TV stuff is like an FCC regulation, and there's only so much you can do with restricting satellite dish access, not zoning, I don't think. Okay, anything else?
Yeah, I did 514.5.1A1. I had noticed a typo. It says the minimum lot R. I'm assuming that you meant to say area.
514.5. Yeah, good catch.
1A1. And then just for my own curiosity and my notes, why do they require them to be blue, gray, or black? And is this all just state statute, as you were stating earlier?
I do believe that there's color references either in state statute or like the 1999 Wireless Act.
I was just curious.
It's so that it's not obtrusive.
Yes.
Okay.
You could have do you remember the candy cane striped towers in like the early 90s where they're white and red striped? Yeah. They're trying to avoid that.
Gotcha. And then moving forward, there's references toward the end in 514.6.12. I was just wondering if there's a definition of a tall structure. The applicant is required to demonstrate that if contacted in writing, the owners of a tall structure. I did flip to the back to see if that was defined after it was raised. I just seemed kind of vague to me.
It is, and my assumption is it's another state statute provision. Wireless telecommunication facilities are generally at the lowest point 75 feet. You might get a little bit lower on like rooftop mounts. So I think we'd be looking at probably anything two stories or taller within that 1500 foot radius.
Sorry for quizzing you.
It's okay.
But thank you for your time.
I think it's purposely vague so that we can encourage them to consider many different sites.
Okay. Does that Have any other comments on questions, concerns, wireless facilities? Okay.
I'll just add one more comment of something we did change. In the current code, there's an odd provision about rooftop-mounted facilities require a special use permit. However, if the property already enjoys a special use permit through a planned unit development, a special use permit is not required for the co-location. We've always found that very difficult to enforce, so we just made it that any rooftop facility will go through a special use permit process.
Okay. All right, moving on to chapter 15, site design standards. Again, I'll ask Director Smetana to provide us with an overview of what we see in the draft code versus what we have in our current code.
Let me get to our summary real quick. I may have to do this the old-fashioned way. I don't know that we have an initial significant change summary from the current code.
I think most of this chapter is new.
A lot of it's new, and we don't have a chapter similar to this in the current code. So chapter 15 is site design standards. It's broken down into 12 subparts. We have general standards, regulations for fences and walls, regulations for dumpster enclosures. We have outdoor lighting regulations, visibility triangle requirements, cross access requirements, sidewalk and pedestrian connectivity requirements, street frontage and access requirements, and we have provisions regarding the division of lots, drive-through facilities, residential driveways, and then traffic studies, which we discussed earlier tonight. For fences and walls, there were not significant changes to our current fence regulations. We did add a provision that all fences shall be elevated 2 inches above grade to allow for the natural flow of stormwater. In the current zoning code, it allows us to request that. I think it's easier just to have that as a requirement moving forward to ensure that fences are not impeding stormwater.
Mike, you also added chain link to the prohibited list?
We did. And I think that's maybe a policy decision for this commission and the village board, but we do have chain link fencing as a prohibited fence type.
And then the ones that are existing would be grandfathered?
Correct. And the other prohibited fences, those are common prohibitions. Barbed wire, concertina wire, electric fences, those are typically fences you don't want in residential neighborhoods.
Yeah, I guess just my own thoughts here are I'm not necessarily a aesthetic fan of a chain link fence. However, I don't know, you know, that I really want to dictate what somebody type of fence they want to put in their yard. There's nothing dangerous about it, you know, as far as allowing for water runoff. I mean, I think it does a pretty good job. So I guess maybe I'll just bring it to my peers here to say, aside from just the aesthetic, at this point almost, you know, to me it's almost a snobbery take on the chain link fence. I don't know that we should be prohibiting somebody's ability to put in a chain link fence. If they're maintained and decent, they are fine. You know, so I guess I'll leave it to my peers to see if anybody else has a comment similar. I think that might be a little bit overreach.
you know if there was any comment, public comment regarding the regulations for fences changing?
I don't believe I've received any, but I don't know that someone would catch that change either.
That's right. I have a big red circle around it in my draft right here. So I see it as consistent with the architectural changes that we're making. You know, the idea of putting regulations in with regards to architectural finishes and the change being consistent with that. I appreciate the fact that somebody might want to put up a chain link fence for purely safety reasons, and it's obviously cheaper. It's the same as, you know, building a house with vinyl siding versus cement board or something. You know, there's sort of a goal, and does the change reach the goal? And I think that's what we're trying to do.
Yeah, what problems does the village see with the chain link fences?
I can't say that I've seen a permit application for a chain link fence in the 3 years I've been with the village.
So mostly aluminum.
It's usually open aluminum architecture. Wood, vinyl, or a wrought iron. You know, chain link fences would already be prohibited as a swimming pool barrier because they can mm-hmm. be climbed. Mm-hmm. It may not be worth regulating because it's not an issue in the village. That's one thought. I'm trying to even picture a chain link fence in the village, and I'm struggling.
You mean like an existing one?
Even an existing one, I can't really.
There's a really unattractive chain link fence on Route 53 separating Volvo from the Amoco gas station.
Okay, so a commercial setting.
And it's a side yard. So it's visible all the way, comes all the way out to the front lot line.
I mean, if you want to do a compromise, you could prohibit it in commercial applications with the thought that a commercial business should be beautifying the property.
I would
particularly when it's on a main corridor.
And I think a lot of HOAs already regulate this.
Yes.
You know, where you can't put a chain link fence if you're in a subdivision with an HOA and declaration of covenants and restrictions, whatever, or there's no fences, period.
We could limit it to just commercial prohibition.
I'm in support of that.
Commissioner Lidell.
Yes. Commissioner Bauer, go ahead.
Sorry. So I apologize. This audio is terrible. So I'm not catching the full discussion, but I think I'm catching enough of it to understand clearly what's being discussed concerning chain link fences. You know, being a resident of, you know, the older, I guess what would be maybe deemed original part of the village, that is, you know, the portion south of the tracks, north of Maple, east of Maine, I can tell you that chain link fences are prevalent. And, you know, I wouldn't doubt that many of them have existed for decades without repair or replacement. That said, in my observation, you know, just having reviewed many zoning codes over the years, I find it to be very commonplace for chain link fences to be prohibited as a matter of aesthetics, and not just in a commercial context, but in all contexts. And so, for example, in neighborhoods, again, like my own, you know, where there is no HOA, there is no declaration that precludes something like a chain link fence, I think, you know, as part of the village's overall effort to improve aesthetics, I think it's appropriate and commonplace to prohibit installation of new chain link fences, or for that matter, replacement of an existing chain link fence. And I don't mean to sound insulting to anyone who has a chain link fence, but again, I find it to be very commonplace for them to be prohibited.
Well, I mean, I don't disagree with you, Commissioner Bauer. I think it just goes to the overall goal of trying to improve the appearance, and whether that's, you know, things like outdoor storage or landscaping or new architectural standards, that they're all consistent with, you know, the, just looking to make a, you know, a general effort to improve everything. I mean, I personally think we could leave it in as a prohibited use. I don't know if there's a way to, you know, come halfway and have somebody be able to replace one that they already have. But anything that's brand new,
I think I still agree with the director's suggestion. And not to belittle Steve's point here, but a wooden fence can be in disrepair and an eyesore just as easily as a chain link fence could be an eyesore in disrepair. I'll just go back to saying, I don't know that we should be regulating somebody's choice on their fence product. And I think the suggestion made, and look, you know, if we haven't had a request for one for 3 years, I don't think we need to worry about it, you know.
Okay, so we have to give some sort of direction. So I'm going to put everybody on the spot here, so we can kind of make a decision on chain link fences. So I'll start with Commissioner Nakamura, if you could tell me what you think.
Yeah, I don't think that the chain link fence should only just be regulated just for the commercial use, that you can't have it for use in a commercial setting, but in a residential situation, depending on, you know, where that residence is, you know, then it may be allowed if it's not displeasing to the other residents in the area.
Well, I don't think we can do that.
No.
So it's almost like a halfway special use permit or something.
Yeah.
I guess I'm envisioning, like, you know, residents backing up to, you know, Maple Avenue, and they put up a chain link fence, where most everybody's putting up solid wood fences, and then you have a chain link, and then there's an appearance issue. And what are you going to do? Regulate by what block they're on, or what's visible from, you know, a major thoroughfare? I don't know.
Could they apply for a variance? I'm thinking no, but
I would say no, because it would be a use variance. So, I can think of two subdivisions that back up to a primary road in the village. I mean, mm-hmm. One is Arbor Ridge.
Yes.
Their approvals require a very specific style fence along Ogden Avenue.
It's like a HOA regulation.
There is no HOA, but the fence requirements were put in the planned unit development, so we enforce
okay.
them.
Okay.
And then Arbor, is it Arbor Trails, the new one on Maple?
Mm-hmm.
They also have very specific fence standards for their subdivision.
Okay.
I believe that all fencing there has to be the aluminum wrought iron style fence.
Open fence.
So
I live in one of those, so I'll ask you that outside of the public meeting, because I'm curious. I would support Commissioner Trussell's suggestion. I think that regulating it for commercial purposes, obviously it would be more common that they're going to be on a public road. I think that people have the right to enjoy their property. And at the end of the day, I think that if they want a chain link fence, that we shouldn't necessarily regulate that. I think we can come up with a lot of conditions and limitations as to where it may or may not be appropriate, but as a general standard, I would support that suggestion.
The benefit of prohibiting them in commercial would also be that you don't have to have the debate whether a chain link fence with the mesh attached to it actually screens outdoor storage or not. So it's probably best just to prohibit them in commercial, because then you're pushing towards a solid fence for screening purposes.
Sure, and where it abuts residential, and
right.
having that argument of what is a solid fence. Okay, so I'm still seeing kind of a split here. So I'm going back to Commissioner Nakamura in terms of basically a choice of prohibiting chain link fences throughout the village, including residential districts, or simply doing the allowing it in residential and not allowing it in everywhere else, commercial, industrial. Like,
yes.
there's no in between.
Yeah, what I had mentioned before is that I would allow it in the actual residential areas, but not in the commercial areas. So
okay.
Agreeing with Mr. Trussell right. that.
Well, I think now we have a majority of people going with the eliminating it in. Allowing it in residential and not allowing it everywhere else. I
It's a step.
Yep.
So the next section goes over dumpster enclosures. There's really not significant changes in regards to those requirements. Filing section is outdoor lighting. Now, there is some significant changes being proposed by staff in regards to outdoor lighting. When you review the village's current outdoor lighting requirements, we believe that the outdoor lighting regulations were likely established as a more of a safety and crime prevention measure under those regulations, because our current zoning code requires outdoor lighting. It mandates sites provide outdoor lighting at different intensity levels depending on the types of uses. When I look at outdoor lighting, all of the complaints that the village receives regarding outdoor lighting is related to the lighting's brightness and the lighting trespass. So village staff thinks it's probably wrong to require and mandate that sites provide outdoor lighting, because that's just creating more complaints. So what the proposed zoning code does is it does not mandate that outdoor lighting be provided. But if it is provided, it does require that the light source be shielded so you cannot see the light bulb. And it does establish maximum lighting levels on property lines. For uses abutting residential zoning districts, it's 0.5 foot candles at any property line. For uses abutting other commercial properties, it's 1 foot candle at the property line.
So what's the requirement right now for lighting at the lot line of a residential?
Let me pull that up.
And I'm assuming this is light on the ground.
It's correct.
Not light, you know, 10 feet above at the lot line.
Well, there's a standard for measuring foot candles. I don't know that if it's on the ground or if it's slightly above the ground, but there is a standard that they use. We verify this at the staff level by requesting a photometric plan being submitted.
Does the outdoor lighting also include any sort of landscape lighting to enhance the property?
We have a landscape chapter in the zoning code. To me, that's a separate topic. So it looks like the current zoning code does not have any maximum foot candle requirement if abutting another commercial property. For single family, it's 0.2. So I'm looking at our draft right now, we're 0.5, so technically we're a little higher. We could drop that down to 0.2 to be consistent with the current zoning code.
Yeah, I think that would be a good thing to do.
Well, you might want to check. A lot of codes use 0.5, and I'm wondering if you can measure below 0.5. You might want to check on that.
Can you explain to somebody who doesn't know the difference of 0.2 to 0.5 what that means for the general public?
Foot candles per whatever. It has to do with the brightness of the light.
Not a light.
So we'll look into that. 0.5 is very common, so we'll have to see why 0.5 is so common.
Can anybody give me an example of a 0.5 light, just for my own reference point?
No. You know,
that's what I was asking.
Very complicated.
You know the little bulbs that they hang on strings in backyards? You know, you've got multiple bulbs.
Right.
So is it the collective of all of those bulbs coming together that is now over 0.5? Is it each individual bulb?
Well, no, it's 0.5 at a particular point.
It's 0.5 at a residential lot line.
Right.
Okay.
So we had a photo.
So all along the lot line, it can't be over 0.5. Regardless of how many lights you have.
Okay.
So I think when we had the photometric study for the Buc-ee's, Buchanan, O'Reilly's. They had a photometric plan in there of the lot, of the lighting at the lot line, and I don't think any of it went over 0.2. Like, it was all really low.
Well, if it did, they would have had a variance request.
Yeah, I know. It was all very low lighting, and I don't know that it's something that's unachievable. I mean, if you can do this at a gas station, which is extremely bright lighting, right? And then shielding and whatnot, and it's not a requirement for the site itself. It's a requirement for the impact on the adjoining residential property.
And I do think we want to be consistent with this current zoning code on that and remain as strict. But what staff did not want to do is mandate that outdoor lighting be provided, mm-hmm. particularly at the levels that the current zoning code requires. I mean, under the current zoning code, it requires 4-foot candles for some uses. That's pretty bright, and that just ends up leading to more complaints by residents.
I appreciate the goal that you're trying to achieve. I think that in all of my time here, the only time I've heard about lighting is complaints. So I agree.
Another change in the outdoor lighting that staff has recommended in this draft is that outdoor lighting that serves sports and recreation areas would be permitted. And it would have to comply with the sports and recreation area lighting manual developed by the Illuminating Engineers Society, which is specifications on how outdoor lighting for athletic fields be prepared and installed. And that manual was written with the approval of the Dark Sky Alliance, so it is pretty strict.
I did make a note next to that section. Is that more strict than the terms that you have here?
Or I think there could be.
Do you need to add a reference? Because I wrote, do we need to add a reference to that they also have to adhere to the standards set forth herein? So you kind of have both.
What we state is that they shall be designed in accordance with, and then we give the publication name.
And
who it's published by.
I'm asking if after that you want to say, and also will adhere to the terms set forth herein.
We could add that. That's going to be stricter, but
I didn't know which one was more strict or not. That's why I had that note there.
So, I mean, this is a change. I will tell you that I think that you could debate whether athletic field lighting is or is not allowed under the current code.
I think
so. This code would allow it, but it would have to be designed following a kind of a standard developed by a rather strict organization.
So is that standard, is that consistent with what the lighting would be on a adjacent residential lot line? Does that include that, or is it the same? Would it be 0.2?
Well, if we adopted the language that Commissioner Biederstadt recommended, that 0.2 would still be in
applicable
play.
To sports and recreation.
Correct. But if we adopt just the language staff recommended, the design and standards for it will fall fully under that separate code.
We've had extensive conversations about golfing and different sports recreational kind of sites throughout all of this process, so that's what comes to mind for me. I'm sure we can all envision one specifically that's been referenced a great deal.
I mean, I think we can just go back a few years ago with the football lighting issue that happened here in Lisle.
Well, and I don't think that it's I don't think it's unique to Lisle. I think sports lighting in general, when it abuts residential, it at minimum goes into special use kind of requirements because it's more than just the lighting, right? It becomes, you know.
I believe that even requiring a special use permit would be relaxing the standard because I think if you were to look at the current code, it would be hard to argue that they can even apply for a special use permit.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm not saying that I'm have opposed to the criteria presented if it doesn't abut residential. But in an area where you're abutting residential, sports lighting is more than just sports lighting. It's now changing the hours of operation.
Should it be a special use permit if adjacent to residential?
That's kind of what I'm thinking.
Adjacent, contiguous?
I don't know what the right word is. I don't know if whatever it is, could be across the street, I guess, and that would still
okay.
be a concern for me. So I guess if you look at something like, you know, like Bennett Academy or something where you have residential.
That would be a special use permit.
Right.
Because they're residential.
Right. So a school football field that needs lighting. It's not just the lighting, and that's why I would say it's just there's more issues at play than just what is the light at the lot line and putting in glare shields and complying with a sports lighting let's say code reference or whatever.
We can add the special use permit for lighting adjacent to residential.
And if that's more relaxed than what we have now, I think we're making progress and putting standards in place so that there's something to comply to rather than leaving it open-ended.
Correct. Okay.
Does anyone else agree, disagree?
I completely agree. I guess I would turn to staff. I'd say the goal is commendable for residential properties. The question is, would bog you guys down with too much oversight or regulation? Or would this just
there's only purpose? A handful of properties that okay. will ever even fall under this provision. So
I would argue the other way, that if we put it in as straight up allowed, that the potential for residents being not happy could be quite high without having an opportunity.
Special use permit provides some cover to staff.
Yeah, well, I mean, people have a right to be heard, and if they think it's going to negatively impact their property, I think they should be given the right to a hearing.
We can add that. The next section in the chapter is visibility triangle. Staff clarified that visibility triangles not only exist at intersections, but they also exist where driveways intersect roadways. This issue does come up from time to time where trees or fences or other objects may block the view of someone using their driveway, so we want to make sure that's regulated. The next section of the chapter clarifies that sidewalks and pedestrian trails need to interconnect on developments. We want folks to interconnect to sidewalks and continue that pedestrian network. The next section clarifies
Mike, I just have one question on the sidewalks.
Yes.
Is there a provision? One of the biggest things that I notice about sidewalks is they're in disrepair.
That's the village's responsibility.
Right. So the village is to repair those, or yes. does the homeowner have to? I moved from the Meadows out to the village, and the Meadows you replaced your own.
So the village has a sidewalk program mm-hmm. that does repairs. Just like the road program, we're not repairing every sidewalk in every part of town every sure. year. There's a cycle. Homeowners, I've seen homeowners decide to repair the sidewalk themselves. Mm-hmm. They have to get a permit, and it has to meet village standards.
If somebody complained about a disrepaired portion
of
the sidewalk.
We would, if there was a tripping hazard or something, the village fixes it.
Okay, very good.
Next section, 515-8. Clarifies that every lot must have frontage on a public street. The next section, 559, clarifies that when dividing lots, those divisions have to comply with the zoning ordinance requirements. 515-10, this is a fairly significant change. Currently in the village code, drive-throughs are unregulated. You won't find regulations related to drive-throughs. It's been past practice to require drive-through facilities to get a special use permit. We just had Schmaltz go through the special use permit process. This proposed zoning code would allow drive-through facilities as a permitted use with design standards that have to be met. I think drive-throughs are going to be very common. I think this pandemic has shown that moving forward, all eating establishments will want to have a drive-through because they've learned now that their operations can be closed. So I think it's important to facilitate that. This will provide some good guidelines that have to be met, but avoid the public hearing process.
And then if they want variances from these specific
then they're going through a public hearing process.
They're going through. So here you have, I'm looking specifically at subsection six, where you have the order box with speakers being set back 50 feet from residential districts, menu board signs set back 50 feet from residential districts. So I could easily see now that this puts you in a situation where when you're abutting a residential district, you're probably in here, right?
That 50-foot setbacks could be hard to meet.
Yes, it will. So.
But if you can meet it, great.
Right.
Let's get you through and avoid.
Right.
The zoning application.
Right. So for those people who are in situation just like the application we just recently reviewed, even if the drive-through was permitted, they would be back in here for a variance instead of a special use permit, because they would never even come close to meeting these 50-foot requirements. So I guess then with regard to this, then as we talked a little bit before, the performance standards come into play with regards to the noise, right? So the 50 feet is intended to address the noise.
The 50 feet's intended to mitigate noise and other impacts on residential.
So if you came in seeking a variance, you're going to have to prove noise is not a problem. And then we're going to need some kind of requirement for, you know, proving that the noise meets a certain appropriate threshold.
Yes. But if you're, you know, on Route 53 or maybe Maple and you don't abut a residential zoning district, you're going to likely be able to install a drive-through without going through a special use permit process. So I think this is good.
I don't disagree. I think it provides the protection for where it's needed, which is, I mean, you know, the queuing out onto a public way is also kind of covered with the minimum stacking that's addressed in here.
Correct.
But the location of the service box and the noise and everything, I think this works, because if you can meet it, it's up to you. You can skip the whole process if you follow the regulations. So it's definitely better than where we are in our code today.
The next section of this chapter establishes residential driveway requirements. There's no changes to those. And the last section, which we've already discussed tonight, is the allowances for staff, this commission, and the village board to request traffic studies.
I did want to follow up on that. So earlier there was discussion in terms of the fact that it's a proposed development. In both paragraph 2 and paragraph 3, you're making reference to proposed development.
Or
obviously
use.
You're assuming what the trip generation would be when it's proposed. What do you do after the fact if it well exceeds what you may have been anticipating after it's developed?
That's a good question. That could be probably raised for every development this village has ever approved.
Well, there's been a big discussion about what occurred in the past this evening. So in the event that you are told one thing and then a year later it turns out it's completely the opposite, what then happens? What do you have as staff to be able to go and say, hey, this isn't appropriate, and then what's the remedy thereafter?
Certificate of occupancy based on .. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, certificates of occupancy are always revocable.
If you had a
zoning approvals are revocable.
How do you put that into effect? That was just my curiosity. I'm not bringing any past event or anything.
Well, the tricky part about this is I feel like we're straddling two worlds too. We have a zoning.
Oh. This is
regulation
jurisdiction,
but we're also looking at the village and how the village chooses to regulate their public streets, which is not zoning.
Okay.
That's more of the police regulations. So we're kind of straddling both worlds.
I'm just thinking that once you get a significant amount of complaints about traffic and about something that you weren't informed of or reasonably could anticipate, what's the remedy?
Well, I think you're seeing the remedy play out in real time with Western Court. I mean, the village board has been discussing that for 2 years. The village has hired a traffic engineer. The village has done traffic counts.
So with this section of 515-2, if this was in our code now, would this have put the burden of the traffic study on the property owner rather than the village paying for the traffic studies? The Western Court scenario.
That was exactly.
Yeah, I think so. But I don't know that the village even did those traffic studies while Amazon was operating.
Yeah, I don't know either, but
In theory, if an issue like that were to arise, this code would allow the zoning administrator, this commission, or village board to require that someone prepare a traffic study.
So I guess the question goes back to Commissioner Biederstadt's original thing is, does it apply just to a proposed development, or does it apply to a proposed development or an existing development? Like something that was approved based on the criteria, and then it somehow doesn't meet it, or it changes, or maybe the use was, as alluded to here before, misrepresented.
I would be hesitant to use it against existing developments. I would rely on the existing developments' entitlements to regulate them.
Okay.
If that existing development was a special use permit, perhaps we need to look at revoking that special use permit. I don't know that I would want to pivot and say, hey, we have a new code, and now we're going to require you to do a traffic study.
No, I'm thinking something that, no, I'm not thinking of going back to an existing use that exists today. I'm thinking like something is a proposed development, you know, this fall, we have the new code in place and it meets the requirements via whatever traffic they submitted. 2 years from now, the use is more intense than represented. And then you want them to go back and revisit it, and the village doesn't pay for that revised traffic study or try to prove that it's the use is intensified. You're asking them to go back and go, you know, you're not meeting the original requirement. You're forcing.
I think we'd have to reword that provision.
I mean, I'm not. No, I don't know if that's an overreach, or if that's just, you know, you submit a traffic study and you hold them to it, as opposed with a certificate of occupancy or a special use permit or something, like it doesn't meet what you originally submitted. I don't know.
No, I agree with what you're saying. Quite frankly, I think you can add a five that says in the event that any proposed development exceeds what they have submitted to the village, and then you raise a great point, they shall at their own expense conduct a traffic study, because why should we as residents of Lisle be then paying for that based upon a misrepresentation?
I think that's standard contract language in a lot of applications. Does it apply to a zoning board though, or to a village, I guess?
I'd throw that at, yeah, I'm not sure.
Well, it seems like it's sort of.
We can work with the village attorney on.
Intensified use.
Appropriate language.
The traffic would be worse.
Traffic would be great to do it. I would want to check the, legally, what constitutes our belief that they've misrepresented or they are not meeting the terms of what they promised us were.
And we're going to have to do some initial, you know, research in order to justify taking enforcement action.
Yeah, but I agree, it's a very good idea to look at that.
Lastly, in that chapter, we do allow decision-making bodies. So this is not something that staff can request, but something that the board can. They may require traffic control improvements, including off-site access and traffic control. So, that's not in the current code. But of course, the village board has the authority to require a development to improve an intersection. This clarifies that authority does exist.
Okay.
It's kind of along the same lines, I'm thinking, right?
Well, I mean, if they think that, you know, a large enough development requires a traffic signal. Okay, so does that wrap up chapter 15? Does anyone else have anything else to add to this chapter?
I don't.
If not, it's 9:40. So the next chapter is architectural design standards. So my guess is that this might go a little longer than 10 o'clock. So before we start, does everyone think we might want to stay till 10:30?
I don't know that we'll get through 16 in that time frame, even closely.
Yeah, that's why I'm kind of asking, do we want to start and stop? Do we want to start and go all the way through it? Because we're not going to finish it by 10 o'clock. There's no way.
We should have time at the next meeting, next week. I think there's only one zoning case scheduled. So, I mean, if we could always focus on 16 in its entirety next week and then be done.
So do you think that by, I hate to ask this question, but the performance standards, do you think that it'd be possible to have some sort of a draft of a performance standards section by next week as well? Or is that too much?
We might get a rough start.
Outline.
Maybe a comparison or some ideas of what other surrounding jurisdictions do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that we'll have the solution of where it goes in the code solved by next week, but we can at least get something for everyone to chew on a little bit.
Yeah, so I'm thinking this would at minimum include noise. I don't know if anyone else has any other suggestions of what would go in a performance standards section. Obviously, the comparison to what other towns are doing. I mean, from my own research, you know, some people are putting this in their zoning code and some people are not putting it in their zoning code. More like policing regulations, nuisance regulations, or things like that. Seems a little bit all over the place and maybe sort of both. Because obviously you could have noise generated by users, you know, i.e. a party. Or you'd have noise generated by rooftop units or things like that, right? So I mean, I think some noise regulation needs to be in there. And I think the issue was kind of raised by way of enforcement when we were talking about the Schmaltz application. If the noise gets loud, what do you do? And what is loud? And what's the standard? And how do you enforce it if there's nothing there? So I don't know if there's anything else that wants to go in there besides noise, but... you know, if we could have something, I think it would help us wrap things up so we could get that final final version of this, hopefully by, you know, July. Is that like yes, maybe?
July or August.
Okay. All right. So before we finish up, does anyone have anything? I guess we need to close a motion to continue the public hearing to next Wednesday.
All three public hearings.
All three public hearings.
Do we need to list those individually to
just by number,
properly
by
make
number
a motion?
Is fine.
I don't have my agenda in front of me.
What did I just do with mine? This would be... a motion to continue public hearings number PZC 2020-12, 2020-13, and 2020-14 until June, what is next Wednesday's date?
So I would move to continue 2020-12, 13, and 14 to the date of June 16th at 7 p.m.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Can I have to do roll call, please?
Commissioner Bierstadt?
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell?
Aye.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Aye.
Commissioner Bauer?
Aye.
Chairman Zeidel?
Aye. Does anyone have anything else that they want to say or do or add, comments, anything? I have something, so I have to ask this for you guys first.
Nothing.
Nothing. Anybody else?
No.
Okay. So, I was asked by several people about the change in the configuration of the Planning and Zoning Commission, and I guess some people just didn't realize what was happening with the new appointment of a chairman and whatnot. So, I thought I would read the resignation letter that was submitted by Chairman Bielat so that people would have at least an opportunity to understand what was going on and why the change was made and why it was made when it was made for the purposes of transparency, I'd say. This is a letter dated April 15th, 2021, in which Chairman Bielat wrote a letter to Mayor Pisak, and it reads as follows. Mayor Pisak, with this letter, I wish to inform you of my intent to resign from the position of chairman of the Village of Lisle Planning and Zoning Commission. Under my leadership, the Planning and Zoning Commission strived for transparency, accountability, fairness, and most importantly, an open public hearing process where residents and applicants felt comfortable expressing their positions. The development of the downtown master plan, instilling concept review process to support new development, improvements along Ogden, and the near completion of the zoning code rewrite are accomplishments that will have an impact on the village for years to come. I want to thank the elected officials and village staff for their support. The pandemic created real challenges, and I appreciate the work that staff put in to ensure that the Planning and Zoning Commission could continue to function. And lastly, I would like to commend my fellow Planning and Zoning Commissioners for their dedication to making Lisle a better place. And we did not always agree on every issue, which resulted in some passionate debate, and yet we always respected each other's other's opinion. Respectfully, Christopher Belap. In addition, I'd like to also let the commission know that I talked to Commissioner Rogers recently, and he did inform me that he did not think he could continue to serve on the commission due to his work conflicts, especially with regards to evening meetings, which are intensifying. These two changes obviously put two vacancies on this board, which has resulted in some challenges in making sure we have quorum and things like this. So hopefully their vacancies will be filled soon. And if anybody's watching and you're interested in volunteering on this board, you know, I would encourage people to send in their application online, and you know, it would be good to have a full commission, I think. So that's all I had to say. So if no one else has anything else, can I have a motion to adjourn, please?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
In a roll call, please.
Commissioner Bierstadt.
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell.
Aye.
Commissioner Nakamura.
Aye.
Commissioner Bauer.
Aye.
Chairman Belap, or Chairman Zidell.
That was good.
Chairman Zidell.
Aye.
In remembrance of.